أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة أيها الإخوة والأخوات الدنيا دار الامتحان فيمتحن العبد يمتحن بالخير أو يمتحن بالشر يمتحن في المال ويمتحن في الفقر ويمتحن في القوة ويمتحن في الضعف وتلك الأيام نداولها بين الناس brothers and sisters respected elders Islamic theology teaches that life is a It's basically a realm that is considered a test. Now, test meaning not in the sense that one is held to grievous circumstances in all times. Times that a person is given wealth, how do they conduct themselves during that time? Are they grateful? Are they dealing with the wealth that they have, distributing it in a fashion that is considered of good? In times of poverty, are they patient? Do they still withhold themselves from transgressing bounds and falling into, for example, stealing because of the desire of need? In times of strength, is one humble? Or does one transgress bounds? In times of weakness, is one patient? Is one relying himself upon the Almighty? Does one still seek out that which is considered of good within the boundaries and limits of their capability? Life is considered a realm of tests. فإخواني وأخواتي، تلك الأيام نداولها بين الناس، فدار الامتحان دار مغفرة أو دار عذاب، دار اطمئنان أو دار فساد، والأمر بيد الله سبحانه وتعالى، ولقد وكلنا الله سبحانه وتعالى بأمور ينبغي لنا أن نتبع به ونأخذ به. إنا هديناه السبيل إما شاكرا وإما كفورا، إنا بينا له الطريق للهدى والحق من الباطل، فالعبد إما شاكرا وإما كفورا، إما أنه يتمسك بهذا الأمر بعدما يوصل إليه وعلمه، وإما يعرض عنه ويفسد في الأرض فسادا. The Almighty سبحانه وتعالى, the merciful, the gracious, He didn't leave the human being to be left alone, but instead He proportioned a system that is innate, unadulterated within themselves until they adulterate it. And consequently, this natural inclination that a person recognizes something more sublime, a greater purpose, is that of the natural disposition the Almighty has placed in the human. What happens is the human grows and he experiences and or she experiences matter and things and elements. And from there, based upon these matters and elements and circumstances, they choose. They choose. And they can continue to rely. They can continue to hold fast to that natural disposition called fitra. And or they can turn away from that natural disposition. Whatever the case, in the times of ambiguity, the Almighty has shown that of good. And He has shown that of wrong. And generally speaking, as human beings, we can recognize that which is of good, naturally, and that which is of a wrong. In the end, this choice that we have, and this observation that we have, إِنَّ هَدَيْنَاهُ السَّبِيلِ إِمَّا شَاكِرًا إِمَّا كَفُورًا, the Almighty has given, shown to them the truth, goodness, a criteria, a differentiation between that which is of wrong and that which is of good. And from there, either the person is grateful, and they hold fast to that which is of good, and or they turn away from that element. God has given us free choice, and that free choice is from His mashiach, is from His permission. Anything that exists is from His permission. But we use this free choice in that which is of good. إِنَّ هَدَيْنَاهُ السَّبِيلَ وَإِمَّا شَاكِرًا إِمَّا كَفُورًا إِنَّ هَذِهِ تَذْكِرَةٌ فَمَنْ شَاءَ اتَّخَذَ إِلَى رَبِّهِ سَبِيلًا. قيل إلينا الله سبحانه وتعالى أن نختار ونجتهد فيما نستطيع. يؤفك عنه من أفك, قتل الخراسون. يؤفك أي اعرض عنه من أعرض عنه. الذي اختار الإعراض اختار أن يعتزل من الحق, فالجزاء من جنس العمل, ورحمة الله سبحانه وتعالى واسعة. Consequently, that criteria is there. There is an element of divine destiny the Almighty has established, but that is in the knowledge of the Almighty. And as the design has, we don't have that knowledge. Consequently, we leave it to something that is far greater and perfect. However, we understand that the repercussion for the things we choose, the retribution and or the reward, the recompense, is given to the individual in a similar fashion. يُؤْفَكُ عَنْهُ مَنْ أُفِكُ. When this criteria is shown to the person of good and you recognize it and you choose to turn away from it, consequently, God turns away, has turned you away. When that truth is shown to you and you choose to abide by it and hold fast to it, consequently, through the permission of the Almighty, you are supported in that element. And both teams doesn't mean the Almighty isn't there and is willing to forgive and pardon. But it's about to the self. It goes back to your sincerity. It goes back to that individual if you want to take a step forward and or not. It goes back to you. فإخواني, سبحان من لا نرى ولكن نراه في صفاته سبحانه وتعالى, كلامه سبحانه وتعالى, في كتابه العزيز. God Almighty, among Islamic theologians and naturally, is considered a being that is unseen, that we are not capable of seeing Him in this realm. We don't have the capability, we don't have the strength per se. However, He is seen through His attributes. He is transcendent through His Word, and the Word is considered the essence of revelation, the element of the Quran. فلذلك إخواني لم يتركنا هملا بل أرسل إلينا كلامه سبحانه وتعالى. He didn't leave us to just be left astray with no type of support. But instead, He has established element that is a hand, an invisible hand. And we're not talking about anthropomorphism here. We're talking about an element of that the Almighty is there of a specific type of support. A specific type of support. فإخواني فلذلك في أيام الفتن والفساد والظروف الذي يتعب النفس والعقل وحقيقة الرجل الذي لا يجن في مثل هذه الأيام كأنه ما هو بعاقل. Consequently, in times of temptation, at times of hardship, at times of corruption, times in which actually the sane individual is led to almost fall insane, to become insane. And who is it that doesn't become insane in such times? That is, the sane individual in such times, how is he not going to fall into some element of being pulled into some type of insanity because of the insanity that is happening around him, that is happening around him? ولكن إخواني لا شك أن الله قد لم يتركنا أملا كما تعرفون ويده سبحانه وتعالى موجودة ونحن لا نتحدث عن اليد الذي مثل الخلق بل هو الخالق وله المثل الأعلى في السماوات والأرض. He didn't leave us astray. There are times of hardship, but that hand is there. And we're not talking again about anthropomorphism here. We're talking about that support, that guidance, that call, that criterion, that element that is not necessarily arbitrary. Do you see? But instead it is something that is devised, calculated. كل شيء عنده بمقدار some calculations سبحانه وتعالى. وأن هذه الأمة حقيقة أمة مرحومة كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. استعجل الله سبحانه وتعالى فتنته في الدنيا ثم الانتقال إلى دار الرحمة والمغفرة للذين أحسنوا في هذه الدنيا حسنة للذين أحسنوا الحسنى وزيادة. Life, and as the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم described, particularly this type of community, is this type of community in essence is a community that is an element of pardon. That is, it is intrinsic within the community there is pardon. There is forgiveness, intrinsically, within the community. And in Islamic theology, the human is not born drowning, philosophically. But instead they are above water. And when they make mistake, they're still in this abode, if they turn sincerity and seek it. That pardon, and even at times, if they don't, just by promoting some type of good. And the wisdom belongs to the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala. But whatever the case, the prophetic tradition teaches that indeed this type of community, this community is a community that is intrinsically in the element of mercy and forgiveness. This is something that is intrinsic in it. It is a sister, it is a brother, it is a father, it is a mother, it is your arm, it is your legs, it is your heart. While this is the element, while this is the circumstance, there are two realms. There is a realm of the second life and there is a realm of the present life. And in the present life, it is considered it is a lighter realm in comparison to the things to come. This is taught in Islamic theology and is also taught in the Abrahamic faiths, Judaic and Christianic elements. That being said, the things that happen in this life, in this realm, is far less in comparison to the things that are to come. In this light, in this difficulty, in the times of sadness, remember that this is far less than the possibilities of things to come. And in this light, in this time of difficulty, in this time of confusion, there is still a hand that a person can seek forth, and sooner or later, the difficulty changes. مع الأسر يسرا مع الأسر يسرا. ولكن نقول إن مع النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام في آياته بعد عسر يسرا ثم بعد ذلك الانتقال للدار الآخرة ففي الدنيا قد يكون عسرا ولكن في الدار الآخرة هي يسر. يعتقدون بعض الإخوان يعتقدون أن معنى الآية أنها الأمر المطلق أن في الدنيا مثلا لا يتعب النفوس ولا تحصل الفساد مثلا ولا الأمر والحزن والبكاء وكل ذلك كلا ولكن لا يخزي الله عبادي أبدا يوما ما تنتقل الغضروف لا شك، وقد يكون أن الانتقال في هذه الظروف المعنوية تحصل في الآخرة ولم تحصل في الدنيا، ولكن الله يمن على العبد في قلبه وصبره ونظرته للظروف والمغفرة والدرجات عنده سبحانه وتعالى قبل الانتقال. فلذلك تجد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في مرضه كما تعرفون قال إن للموت لسكرات، رواية مشهورة. وغير ذلك من الأئمة قالوا نفس الشيء، ولكن يعرفون وعد الله سبحانه وتعالى حقا، لا يخلف الله ميعاده سبحانه. We tend to think the well-known Wisdom-felt statement that after hardship comes ease. But our interpretation at times is confused with reality. Life doesn't necessarily mean that you're in a hard circumstance and then in this life it's going to turn out to be even easier. This isn't necessarily the case. The perfection of ease, the perfection of utopian society, an everlasting bliss, an ever time of happiness, is not necessarily meant for this type of realm. The fragrance that a person sees is there. There is happiness, there's no doubt about that. And there is smiles and there is times of ease. But it is not something that is a must upon life for its innovative existence. A promise of God, that is. However, there is a type of intrinsic support, that hand that we're talking about, and again, not anthropomorphism, that a person is given type of strength, spiritual strength, that they are able to handle such circumstances. Prophet ﷺ, before he passed, he said, verily, death has its agonies, إِنَّ الْمَوْتِ لَسَكَرَاتِ. Death has its agonies, and this is considered Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, who is considered he of nearness of the Almighty. And the narratives of those beforehand, and the righteous beforehand, that were better than I and better than you, it's reality. But that doesn't mean in of itself, again, the Almighty is not aware or doesn't like you and or has turned you away. Nay, but instead, this community is a community that is given an intrinsic mercy and forgiveness. And the things of hardship are given in this life before the changing of something far greater and or more important that may occur. إن هذه أمة مرحومة عند الله سبحانه وتعالى وهذا من بشر الله سبحانه وتعالى علينا. قل قولي هذا استغفر الله لي واستغفره إنه غفور رحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. بشرنا الله سبحانه وتعالى بأمور كثير، ونعتقد ولا شك كلنا نعتقد أو نرجو من الله أن نجعلنا من الذين قد أحسنوا في الدنيا والآخرة عندهم الحسنى عندهم سبحانه وتعالى. The Almighty has given us quite a bit of glad tidings. When we say us, the human being. Just that one step of sincerity, just being sincere, is a means for a person's success by his mercy and grace. It may be a means for a person's success by the Almighty's mercy and grace. One step of sincerity. One step in attempting to hold fast to that sincerity. لا شك كلنا نريد أن نتقرب إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى بما نستطيع. There's no doubt that every one of us wants to continuously grow spiritually and draw closer to the Almighty in a way that suits His Majesty. وقد سمعنا الكلام عن الأبرار. إن الأبرار لفي نعيم، إن الفجار لفي جحيم، يصلونها يوم الدين. إن الأبرار لفي نعيم على الأرائك ينظرون، تعرف في وجوه نظرة النعيم. We hear much about the righteous, a description of a people, of things to come. The righteous in a time frame in which they are reclined in happiness, and upon them is a light of illumination, نظرة. A type of illumination is upon them, a type of happiness. فتجد أن في القرآن أن الله يذكر الأبرار كثير، يذكرهم كثيرا. ولكن سبحان الله من هم؟ The Almighty describes these righteous people much, but the question is who are these people? You see, who are these people? Who are these people that have this specific, special connection with the Almighty, if we may say? It doesn't mean the Almighty is not connected to everybody. But a connection is something relative, and some people are more connected than others. What remains is the Almighty's infinite attributes. But for some, there's a special type of connection. Your step forward is a step forward closer to the Almighty, a relative format of the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala تكلم على الانتقال من الدنيا والآخرة وتكلم عن قوم وجوه يومئذ ناظرة إلى ربها ناظرة ناظرة شقت الأبواب والفرح والسرور وجوه يومئذ ناظرة إلى ربها ناظرة ولكن الذي يقرأ السورة لا يعرف من هم من هم الذي وصفهم الله بوجوه من وجوه ناظرة من أولئك القوم. So we have an interesting phrase that's found in the chapter of the resurrection that talks about a people that their faces on that day is illuminated, an illumination. We say much an illuminator or numerary. But in this circumstance, a person is in a circumstance of illumination, tranquility, of happiness, looking upon their Lord in a way that suits His majesty. But what's interesting in this phrase, in this chapter of the Qur'an is known as the Qiyamah, it's not described who they are. لَمْ تَذْكُرْ مَنْ أُولَٰئِكَ الْقَوْمُ وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاظِرَةٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ. It's not described in the chapter in which the phrases are mentioned who these people are. وَلَكِنْ إِخْوَانِي أَنَّ الْقُرْآنَ كَسُورَةٍ وَاحِدَةٍ فَلِذَلِكَ تَجِدُ الْأَخْبَارَ فِي مَوَاقِعٍ أُخْرَى قَدْ فَصَّلَ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى كَلَامَهُ. Which brings us to an extremely important point, is that the Qur'an, though it is distributed in a certain type of chapters, it is still considered one chapter, that it describes itself in various phrases. وَقَدْ أَخْطَأُ الْعِبَادَ حِنَمَا يَتَمَسَّكُونَ بِقَوْلٍ وَاحِدًا وَلَمْ يَتَمَسَّكُونَ بِالْأَخْوَالِ كُلَّهِ. And people have made mistakes, particularly in this realm when it comes to Islamic theology and studies, when they hold fast to one statement that is mentioned one area or a corner, and they leave all the other statements aside. Subhanallah, ikhwani, nurid an nakuna min ulaika alqawm wujuhun yawma'idha nadhira ila rabbiha nadhira. Walakin wajad al-wasf ba'da thalika fi surat al-insan, surat al-ladhi ba'da. Hal ata'a al-insani hinun min al-dahri lam yakun shay'an madhkura. Inna khalaqna al-insana min nutfatin amshajin nabtalihi faja'alnahu samiyan basira. Inna hadaynahu as-sabeel imma shakir wa imma kafura. إِنَّا عَتَدْنَا لِلْكَافِرِينَ سَلَاسِلَ أَغْلَالٍ وَسَعِيرًا إِنَّ الْأَبْرَارَ يَشْرَبُونَ مِنْ كَأْسٍ كَانَ مِزَاجُهَا كَافُورًا عَيْنًا يَشْرَبُ بِهَا عِبَادُ اللَّهِ يُفَجِّرُونَهَا تَفْجِيرًا يُوفُونَ بِالنَّذْرِ يَخَافُونَ يَوْمًا كَانَ شَرُّهُ مُسْتَطِيرًا وَيُطْعِمُونَ الطَّعَامَ عَلَى حُبِّهِ مِسْكِينًا وَيَتِيمًا وَأَسِيرًا إِنَّمَا نُطْعِمُكُمْ لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ لَا نُرِيدُ مِنْكُمْ جَزَاءً وَلَا شُكُورًا إِنَّا نَخَافُ مِنْ رَبِّنَا يَوْمًا عَبُوسًا قَمْطَرِيرًا وَوَقَاهُمُ اللَّهُ شَرَّ ذَلِكَ الْيَوْمِ وَلَقَاهُمْ نَضْرَةً وَسُرُورًا الأبرار. النظرة وجوه يومئذ ناظرة نظرة وسرورا وصفهم الله سبحانه وتعالى بعد ذلك السورة الذي بعد. So what's really interesting is in this chapter, Al-Qiyama, the resurrection, a description of these individuals that their faces are illuminated. But that description is not found in detail. But what happens is that the chapter right after, it describes them, a description of who they are, what type of people they were, based upon their sincerity. And in this description, you find very interesting points, an egalitarian perspective, per se. The people that were trustworthy, people that were truthful to their vows, children that stood up to truth, the concept of prayer, the concept of charity, the concept of feeding people that are in need, not for any type of prideful, worldly, arrogant need or matter, but instead for the face of the Almighty, the countenance, better to say, of the Almighty. But what's very interesting is a particular description that is found. طَيْمُ الطَّعْمَ عَلَى حُبِّهِ مِسْكِينًا وَيَتِيمًا وَأَسِيرًا أَسِيرًا تَتَخَيَّلُوا إِخْوَانِي وَسَخُوا اللَّهُ بِالْأُسْرَةِ وصفهم أن هؤلاء القوم يطعمون طعامهم منهم. فلذلك تجد عبد الله بن عباس وغيرهم من العلماء السلف وغيرهم كانوا يتحدثون على أقوام في ظروف صاروا وصفهم الله بذلك ولكن مع ذلك أمرهم الله أن يطعمهم ويسقيهم. ومع ذلك قالوا بعد ذلك إذا هذا كانت الوصف للرجل الفلاني على هذه الصفة فكيف إذن للرجال الأخرى الذي ما هم بهذه الصفة وبعينها إخوانك على يمينك وشمالك. إذا وصفنا الله إذا أمرنا الله أن نتعامل معهم بذلك فإذا كيف بالأخوك وأختك؟ نتعجب إخواني نتعجب. And what's very interesting is this particular phrase of a people who feed people that are imprisoned. This is the description of these righteous people that in the afterlife they're full of illumination and happiness. They feed the people that are imprisoned. And based upon this element, freeing the slaves that have been constructed to chains and latches. And based upon this philosophy, those people that are simply in need, those people that call out for a type of, any type of help. And what's interesting is this description is given to a people in times of a philosophical circumstance would involve two realms. And in this circumstance, striving between one another and a person is captured, and then they are dealt with in this fashion, to give of your own bread to this individual. The abolition of slavery, of course, stems from the Islamic concepts of slavery and the freeing of slaves. But what happens, a thing to consider, is that we tend to forget about people that are more deserving as well. I don't say more deserving, but people that are your brother and or your sister. People that are called in the concept of community to be as a one body. And you find the lack of such urgency within such cults. Subhanallah, أنا أذكر أن رجل اسمه William Durant ونصراني كتب تاريخ كبير يسمىها The Story of Civilization. هو كان يتكلم عن الإسلام والمسلمين ومن الأمور التي تكلم عن لماذا أعتقد كثير من غير المسلمين بالإسلام دخلوا في الإسلام وبعينها قوم من أهل الكتاب كثير من أهل الكتاب يدخلون في الإسلام. فسبحان الله يتكلم عن هذا ثم قال لأن الإسلام دين سليم طيب سهل واضح لمن كان يريد واضح. وكما تعرفون قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الدين يسر ومن يشاد الدين أحد إلا غلبه فسددوا وقاربوا وبشروا واستعينوا بالغدوة والروحة وشيء من الدلجة كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. فهو قال ذلك وبعد ما انتهى من كلامه ضرب مثلا والمثل الذي أتى به من القرآن الكريم قال الله في سورة البقرة ليس البر أن تولوا وجوهكم قبل المشرق والمغرب ولكن البر من آمن بالله اليوم الآخر والملائكة والكتاب والنبيين وآت المال على حبه ذوي القربى واليتامى والمساكين وابن السبيل والسائرين وفي الرقاب وأقام الصلاة وآت الزكاة والموفون بعهدهم إذا عاهدوا والصابرين في البأساء والضراء وحين البأس أولئك الذين صدقوا وأولئك المتقون. قال هذا دين الله هذا دين الإسلام. فلذلك كثير منهم دخلوا فيه لأن كانت أمر واضح جليل طيب سهل بفضل الله سبحانه وتعالى العباد. والشاهد وراء ذلك حينما قال وجوه يومئذ ناظرة إلى ربها ناظرة يتحدث الله عن الأبرار ووصفهم من الله سبحانه وتعالى بعد ذلك في الصورة وكذلك وصفهم في هذه الآية في سورة البقرة. فليست البر بعينها فقط بالجوارح بل هو أمر عقدي طيبة النفس الروح الطيب. والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال يدخلون الجنات أقوام قلوبهم كالطير أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام طير لطيف رقيق القلوب مخلصا لله سبحانه وتعالى. William Durant, famous historian in the earlier 1900s, wrote a work, magnificent work, it's called The Story of Civilization. And he talks about Islam and Muslims in one portion of it. And then he talks about an interesting scenario. He says that over the centuries, Islam and Christianity, etc., they overlapped much. And anyone who studied history knows this very well. One point he discusses is how the interchanging between the two religions of its people folding into one another, and a scenario of people that held fast to the methodology of Jesus falling into the footsteps of Islam, and accepting it as a message of truth. He describes his reasoning and what he places before The writer is a very interesting verse he chose out of all the verses. And it is the verse that describes those righteous people who are given this type of illumination, particularly in the next coming world life. And in this scenario, he says, this is the context of Islam. It is clear, it is pure, it is easy, and it overlaps the fundamental call of natural instinct, and it also overlaps the call of what has been divinely called beforehand. And in this description, prayer, yes, charity, yes, but you also find the freeing of slaves. You see, you also find the sincerity, and you also find a very important statement in which he says that mere action, you see, mere action alone is not a representation of the righteousness of the individual. Mere action is not a representation of the righteousness of the individual. It is something intrinsic, it is something sincere. Everyone stands the same platform. Everyone can say whatever they want on the tongue. People can say what they want. But the reality is what is found within, and that is the means of the person's success. Two persons could say the same thing. One person is closer to the Almighty. Two persons can stand on the same platform and pray. One person is closer to the Almighty. One person can pray on many prayers while another person's prayers are limited. But that sincerity is there. And a person who's able to combine the sincerity with action as a person that is in a very blessed circumstance. إخواني وأخواتي الظروف في العالم لا شك متعبة محزنة لمن كان له قلب أو ألقى السمع وهو شهيد أتعجب من الإخوان الذي حتى مرة واحدة لم يبكون أو يسير على وجوههم الدموع أنا أعتقد أن الرجل الذي في مثل ذلك الظروف ينبغي أن يراجع نفسه. Brothers and sisters, there is a lot of sadness out there. There is no doubt about that. There is a lot of ambiguous circumstances, things that no sane person, if he just allows himself, does not control himself, may possibly be led to falling into insanity because of the insanity that happens. The strange person nowadays is the person that is not insane. Pardon me, the strange person nowadays is the person that is, again, not strange. It's not insane. Insanity seems to be the common circumstance now. Whatever the case, one sad thing, one sign of a person's, you can say, weakened heart, is not even a tear dropped down from the face of a person. Not even one tear when they see all of these things happening. Not even one sense of sadness for other people's circumstances, difficulties. And you know very well, if this is the circumstance, believe me, we're not in a good shape at all. We are not in a good shape at all if this is the type of circumstance that we're living in right now. والله تعالى أعلم ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين اللهم إياك نعبد ولك نصلي ونسجد وإليك نسعى ونحفل نرجو رحمتك اللهم إنا نستعينك ونستغفرك ونثني عليك خير ولا نكفرك ونؤمن بك سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين